choose the razor that is built for you. Light and regular and heavy. Hey, slick shave for any beard. Olay!
Hey, how you guys doing? Xander J. Hobson here, the Brilliant Artist Movement, and this is another episode of The Remarks. As you all know, I used to be a pretty good amateur boxer, but nevertheless, after I got into girls, that was pretty much it for me in boxing, even though I hung around for a while and embarrassed myself. My late trainer, a man by the name of William Smiley Hayward, he tried to get me into the administrative end of prize fighting, and the administrative end being the guys who don't do the fighting, the trainers, the cut men, the managers, and even the promoters. But I wanted no parts of the administrative end of boxing. I was a guy that was hell-bent on the operations end. The operations and being the guys that get in the ring and do the fighting, even though I was no longer suited to do that. Well, a couple of weeks ago, as I was thinking about who I was going to do my next boxing documentary on, I decided that I would do a documentary on J. Russell Peltz, the administrator of Philadelphia boxing. Russell Peltz, a man who has been in the boxing business on the promotions ends of boxing for more than 50 years. I remember seeing Russell Peltz when I was a young kid at the Blue Horizon, where he held most of his events. I used to see him at the gym. A guy by the name of Harold Moore, who they called Spitz, was his matchmaker. He used to come around to the gym. The reason why I mention Harold Moore, because I went to school with his daughter, Shelly. And I figured I have to mention Harold Moore because he was like one of Peltz's guys who put fights together. So with that said, we're going to dive into this interview, and we're going to have a great documentary on J. Russell Peltz and Philadelphia boxing. Bam.
Yes, sir. Can you hear me loud and clear?
Yeah, but you got to call me Russell. Stop calling me sir. Okay?
Well, listen what I'm saying.
Request.
Okay, you got it, Russell. I will call you Russell. Well, the reason why I refer to you as sir, to be totally honest with you, because when I was a young kid, I remember you, and all of you guys were full-grown men when I was a kid. So that's my comfort zone because you guys are my elders.
How old are you?
I'm 52 years old, February the 1st, 1968.
Okay.
Yeah. That's what I'm saying. You know, so when I say Mr. to you, it's actually not over the top because...
I know, but I don't like it. It makes me feel old.
Well, no, I'm not, and I'm not going to make you feel old, so I'm going to try to adapt and get used to calling you Russell.
Well, what do I call you, Chuck?
Xander J. Hobson is the name that I prefer to use on stage, but please call me Chuck. That's what my friends call me.
It's Chuck and Russell. Okay, very good.
Enough about me, sir. This here documentary, this interview I'm doing, is about you. And the very first thing I want to know about you, Russell, is what does the J stand for in J. Russell Peltz, sir?
Doesn't stand for anything. That's why there should not be a period after it. My father, the J is the first name officially. My father put it on my birth certificate as a wise guy.
Okay.
There was a financier at the turn of the last century named J. Pierpont Morgan.
I don't
know if this J had a period or not, but it doesn't stand for anything.
Well, you know,
that is officially the name, the letter J.
Hey, that's pretty cool because you look at it. When you see a person with J in their name, you know they dead serious. You understand? For example, J. Jonah Jameson. You know, you can't mess around when a guy has a J in his name. I see that you You graduated from Lower Merion High School, the same high school as Kobe Bryant. What part of the city are you from, sir?
Well, I was born in Winfield, right across the street from the Inglis home.
Yeah.
But after second grade, we moved to Ballackinwood. We lived exactly two blocks behind the Ballackinwood Shopping Center, right when it was being built in around 54.
I like the fact that you married your college sweetheart at one juncture and your high school sweetheart at another juncture, and you guys have been together for 43 years. Two children, two sons, sorry about your late son, and you got a bunch of grandkids. So that's I think, you know, nothing like, you know, being with someone who you know from the sandbox, you know?
But she wasn't the woman I'm married to now, Linda, was not my high school sweetheart. We were in the same homeroom for 3 years, but we never even said hello to each other, even though I had a crush on her.
Well, there you go. So
3 years later that we got together.
Well, put it like this. She was your sweetheart, but you wasn't hers. You understand? But that's a good thing. It's nothing like ending up with somebody that you know you were had a fondness for. I tell you something real quick. So I've been married twice. My first wife, I got on her nerves so bad, she died to get away from me. And my current wife, she often gets on my nerves so bad, I think about dying to get away from her. You know what I mean?
Well, I got a better one for you. After we started dating, me and Linda, I asked her where she went to elementary school.
Right.
And she went to man's school in Winfield, where I went.
Wow.
And we're the same age. And my mother had saved the class picture from 1952, our homeroom class, and I'm on the third row, and she's on the second row, almost right in front of me.
Wow, you guys never seen each other. Amazing.
Yeah.
Sound like you were destined to be with her, sir. You're going to have to get used to me. We're going to go back and forth between Russell and Sir, because I have to acclimate my mind to calling you Russell instead of Sir. You know, Mr. Reddish used to get after me about that, too, because I often called him Sir, and he used to get after me about that. So, you know, I think we'll have that in common.
I'm a young kid compared to you, sir. I mean, I'm 49, so I know you're at least 50. So,
Have you ever been involved in any other type of entertainment besides boxing?
No, I was a sports writer before I got into boxing, no.
Oh, really? Who'd you write for?
I was a copy editor at the Evening Bulletin. My last year and a half at Temple, I worked the midnight shift, midnight to 8, and I edited copy, and then I worked for about... I worked there from the summer of 67 until the summer of 69, yeah.
Oh, wow. I was 1 year old when you left that place. Did you ever box yourself, or if not, what other sports did you play? Did you, you know, play in high school or college or anything like that?
I played in the Junior Jewish League basketball.
Really?
In high school. And I took, when I was... Let's see, 1960, June 1960. When I was 12, 1320 Arch Street, which later became the headquarters for the Philly, the blue-collar union workers. It was called the Elks Club.
Right.
And I went there on Saturday mornings after Hebrew school to learn how to box. And at the end of the season, there was about 16 of us in the class. We had a tournament. And I like to say I was in the semifinal because I was in the seventh bout.
Right.
And the fathers came in as the judges, and I boxed it. There was 8 fights. There was 6 winners. There were 7 victors and 1 draw. I was in the draw, and I got a little copper medal with a boxer on it. And this was June 4th, 1960. I didn't get it engraved for almost 40 years, but about maybe 10, 15 years ago, I went and got it engraved. I looked up in the internet what was the first Saturday in June, which was 1960, so I had it engraved. It's Spike's Trophies.
So how did you get into the promotions and the administrative end of boxing?
Well, I fell in. I saw my first fight on TV in August of '59 when I'd come home from summer camp. It was Gene Fulmer against Carmen Basilio for the NBA middleweight title, and I just got. I was fascinated. It was the first time I'd ever seen a fight. Let's see, '59. So I was 12. Yeah, I was 12, and I just fell in love with it. And my dad took me to. I'd watch it on TV, and then as a present for my 14th birthday, he took me to my first fight at Convention Hall, December 6, 1960. Len Matthews was in the main event. And I walk into Convention Hall, and there's like 5,000 people. And I was fascinated because this was a slice of life that I'd never seen before.
Right.
Be around blacks and Hispanics. And it's funny because after that, every time I would watch a fight on TV, I was always rooting for the black guy. My mother didn't want my father taking me anymore. She didn't want her little Lord Fauntleroy to be with the boxing element.
Right, you know?
I ain't got nothing good to say about Russell Lingus. No, Russell Peltz is my boy. No matter what people say about him, he stays into the boxing game as a businessman, and he's not into it like favoritism or no way or other. He keeps it real. He like good fights. Russell like top fights. We did business before as I was promoting and he was promoting, and he had one of his guys meet one of my guys because he always wanted to know why I wouldn't let him fight. I gave him a fight. I told him this one is on the house. You never seen my guy's match? I said, now we got a good match here. My guy shut his guy down, you know. So, but we always been, Russell been a rivalry with me, but he's a good guy. Me and him are real good friends. Me, him, and Johan, them is real good friends. I had nothing good but good to say about him.
I was a sports fanatic. I used to hang out at the Palestra all the time in the 60s, and you would come out of the Palestra. I mean, every game was like down to the wire, and it was always sold out in the school spirit. And you'd come out of the Palestra on such a high.
Right.
You couldn't wait to tell somebody what you just seen.
Right.
And I came out of there one night, and I said, you know what's the best way to tell somebody? Write about it. I was a journalism major in college.
Ah, okay.
I decided in ninth grade I was going to be a sports writer.
Okay, cool.
And I took journalism in college, and my major achievement was, in 1968, I was awarded the Outstanding Male Journalism Graduate at Temple.
Wow.
In 68. But I'd already been working by that time full-time at the Bulletin. And the boxing writer there, a guy by the name of Jack Freed, had been covering boxing since 1930, and we didn't get along.
Wow.
Because in 1968 and 69, he's still referring to Muhammad Ali in print as Cassius Clay.
Okay.
And I would change it. When the stories came in and I would edit them, I would change it. Go crazy and run down to the composing room and tell the linotype operators to change it. Because in those days, the Bulletin would have five or six editions.
Right.
So we never got along. And, you know, he kept getting extensions on his retirement. And I didn't want to wait around for him to die to get his job.
Right.
So when you work in the midnight shift, you have a lot of free time.
Mm.
So I would go into what they called the morgue, the Bulletin Library, where you would have every story that was ever printed in the history of the Bulletin, which at the time was the oldest continuous afternoon newspaper in the country. And I'd start pulling out the file from the Blue Horizon, and I wrote down who fought, what night of the week it was, how many people went, what was the gross receipts, what were the net receipts, and I'd make these long lists, and I studied them. And going to Temple, I lived at home, and I had also been an editor on the Temple, the student newspaper, for 3 years, and I'd worked in the composing room there, and I got paid for that as an editor, and I was making money at the Bulletin. And living at home, I had no expenses, so I had about $5,000 saved up by the spring of 1969. I said, you know what, why take a shot? You know, you got to do it when you're young and you can take a shot. I don't understand, a 22-year-old kid promoting Benny Briscoe and George Benton and Leotis Martin, it was unheard of.
Yeah.
Think about that. Think about 22 years old. And boxing was like dead in Philly.
Right.
69. Even though it was a post-Olympic year, from January to September, there were only five carts in the whole city.
Wow.
And then I started coming along, and I started promoting from September 30th to May 18th, because you didn't promote in the summer without air conditioning.
Ah.
So that's like 7.5 months. I ran 15 shows.
Wow.
Okay, and I got a ton of publicity, first of all, because I was a kid.
Right.
And I was reviving boxing, and we had a lot of talent, Cyclone Hart, Sammy Goss, Willie the Worm Monroe, Boogaloo Watts, Jimmy Young. I'm, you know, George Benton fought for me. I mean, it's an honor.
Right.
For me to tell people that George Benton had his last two fights in Philly for me.
Wow, that is something to say, man. That's heavy.
So, you know, I was like a kid in a candy shop. These guys I've been paying to see fight. Now they were fighting for me, and I almost lived at Champ's Gym. I went to all the gyms, but
right.
Champ's Gym was the main gym. Champ's Gym, which was right around the corner from the 23rd PAL,
right,
22nd and Columbia. That's where I spent all my evenings.
That's where the first time I ever saw you was up at Champ's Gym, right up there at 24th and Columbia, which is now Cecil B. Moore. I spent a lot of evenings on that bench at the Champs Gym watching them guys box.
Right, right. It was around the corner. It was a second floor walk up.
Yeah, exactly. That's where
Briscoe trained for the Monzone fight in that gym.
Wow.
In 72.
Sir, why did you stop holding shows at the Blue Horizon in the 90s, maybe, or 2000? I'm just curious about that.
I couldn't get along with the women who owned the building.
I might get in trouble here, but women could be some rough characters. So say no more, sir. I totally understand you there. I'll leave it at that. What was the? I think I read that your last fight at the Spectrum was in 1980. Who do you remember? Who your last? Who fought that last fight at the Spectrum?
Sure, Jeff Chandler knocked out Javier Flores in the 10th round.
Wow,
man. The NABF and USBA bantamweight titles.
Wow, amazing.
Yeah, February 1st, 1980.
Wow, that was my birthday, man. I turned 12 years old that day.
There you go.
Yeah, amazing. Sir, I got another question for you. Who were some of your favorite fighters, trainers, and managers to work with, and why?
Well, listen, my favorite fighter, of course, was Benny Briscoe, because he was my first fighter.
Oh, okay, there you go.
You know, I mean, you know, when I say my first fighter, you know, the first fighter that I, how do you say this, that I guided his career from the time my brother-in-law bought his contract in the summer of 1970 until we split up in January of 80 when I wanted him to retire and he wouldn't.
Ah.
It was a different world back then because guys just wanted to fight.
Right.
So he was my favorite fighter. I mean, Jeff Chandler, of course, you know, he's up there. Another guy who, I mean, I would go into the gym and I'd say, Jeff, we're going to fight, blah, blah, blah. And he'd say to me, can't you get me anybody better?
Wow.
I mean, that mindset doesn't exist anymore.
Right.
It really doesn't.
Right.
I mean, today I get calls, can you get me 6 wins in a row? I say, you're calling the wrong guy.
I had a good amateur career and expected to go in the pros and start off with a couple easier fights. So I didn't sign with Russell because Russell, who wasn't having that, he wanted all competitive fights. So I wound up signing with other promoters and got tougher fights than what I would have with Russell. I had 8 out of 8 fights. I fought 2 world champions, to be world champions. And one guy I fought in the Nationals and beat him. We fought during our 3rd fight. So after a while, you know, me and Mr. Cooley, we decided to go to Russell after all that. And we wound up going to him with our last 2 fights. And, you know, that's how I won. Russell was a great, great promoter.
I've known Russell as long as he's been in boxing. Yeah, but he started out as a newspaper journalist for the old Evening Bulletin. But he didn't do that for long. He started the boxing promotion business.
Okay.
And the two things that make him stand out, because a lot of people start off try to be boxing promoters, and it's a lot more than they're ready for. But the two things that I always thought about him was, the first was he ran it like a business.
Okay.
He didn't, whereas other promoters would give free tickets or try to build a crowd up a little bit and do things, he wouldn't do that. Everything was business. Two that made him really well, do well as a promoter, was his matchmaking.
Okay, he was a great matchmaker. Cool.
Great matchmaker. And back in the day, people are matched so that they won't win. In other words, they're trying to build somebody's record up or something.
Right.
But not with Russell. I don't know how much you remember back in the day, but the Tuesday night fights at the Blue Horizon.
Right, okay.
See, he got the contract for that. And it really built up his reputation and did a lot for his promotion business. If the manager wanted to get a fight for his boxer, and he approached Russell about it, Russell would match whoever you were going to fight with Russell. It was going to be a hard fight.
Right.
I had a lot of top, Marvin Johnson, 3-time light heavyweight champion.
Right.
I mean, Willie the Worm, Cyclone Hart. I like Boogaloo Watts. He doesn't like me.
Mm.
That's a long story. Tyrone Everett and I never really got along, but I only because I thought he could have been even better than he was.
And he was
really... It was frustrating for me to watch him play it safe sometimes. But, you know, then I'll hear, well, you're not the guy in there taking punches. I said, okay, but this is the business you chose.
Right.
You know, I can appreciate a Pernell Whitaker fight as much as anybody, but I don't want to go to a show of 8 Pernell Whitaker fights.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Right.
Well, I'll go to a show of 8 Joe Frazier fights.
Right.
8 Benny Briscoe fights.
Right.
Sure.
Right.
Because that's what people want to see. I don't want to hear about the manly art of self-defense. I mean, you know, it's just, I mean, a guy comes along like Gypsy Joe Harris, okay.
Right.
That's something special, but, you know, he was ahead of his time.
Right.
My favorite managers are the guys who didn't give you any trouble about who you were fighting, like Penny Schaefer and Pat Duffy, who had Leotis Martin and Sammy Goss.
Mm.
I mean, I'm trying to think back to the days when we had managers, because honestly, Chuck, today the promoters are really the managers.
Wow.
Managers, wow. Managing a fighter today is more like a babysitting thing.
Mm.
Back then, before the advent of promotional contracts, where a fighter would be tied to one promoter, a manager could maneuver his fighter by running up the price. Well, you know, Lou Lucchese offered me $3,000. Russell, you're only offering me $2,500.
Right.
Same fight, and it was different. But you know, the first guy I really got close with as a trainer, even though we had rough times later, but got back together, was Quenzel McCall.
Okay.
Because he was the guy I met the first night I walked into Champ's gym, because he ran the place.
Right. Right.
And we had a really wonderful relationship for a long period of time. And, of course, he was Benny Briscoe's trainer from 70 through 74, and we traveled the world together. You know, Sam Solomon was very nice at first with Cyclone Hart. And, listen, it's like when I say at first... You get married. It's not 100%. You're going to have arguments. You're going to have fights.
Right.
There's
right.
No such thing as a perfect. You're dealing with money.
Right. Right.
That's the thing.
Right.
Like fighters come to me today, and they say, "Geez, why didn't I stay with you? You know, I appreciate what you did for me." But when you're dealing with money, it changes the whole perspective. Like sports, where like fighters love the journalists. They love the sports writers because they're writing about it.
Right.
So they have a different relationship with a fighter than I do because we're dealing with money.
Right.
And we're arguing how much money are you going to get because, honestly, Chuck, the old-timers understood that people in boxing today, they don't really know what it takes
right.
to promote a show.
Right.
They don't know that you have to spend $800 on the ambulances or $3,000 on security or the hotels and the meals and all the licenses you have to take and the liability insurance and the $3,000 for the boxer's insurance. And when you're running a small show, when you don't have television, it's like I'm writing a book about my life in boxing. And I saved everything.
Right.
I saved every profit and loss statement I ever had. I saved every contract that was ever signed.
Wow.
And I look back on it, and I see, I said, Jesus, how did I make it all these years with the money we were losing on shows? But you would develop a fighter. You could lose, like, let's say you did five shows in a row at the Blue Horizon, and you lost, like, $10,000 in total in those days.
Yeah.
What $10,000 was worth. But then a guy like Briscoe or Marvin Johnson would get a big fight, you know, and you'd make it up. You'd make the money back. So you're always looking to develop fighters.
Right.
Because you can't get rich promoting small club shows.
Right.
I mean, at least until the 90s when the Blue Horizon got so hot and we were on national television every month, it was different. But,
right.
You know, but you couldn't have, still couldn't have made it without the money from USA Network.
Wow, okay.
So,
okay.
Tough road.
Speaking of great fighters, right? Well, my favorite fighter of all time is Marvelous Marvin Hagler. And, sir, he boxed for you a total of 5 times. He lost twice. Sir, what was it like working with Marvelous Marvin Hagler and the Petronelli brothers? And tell me about when Marvin Hagler came through Philly and straightened some people out, sir. I need to hear that.
Well, listen, in the 1970s, Philadelphia and Paris were the middleweight capitals of the world.
Paris, France?
Just look, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, because we went over there several times with Briscoe, and Willie the Worm fought over there, too. So we had Briscoe and Hayward and Little Abner and Cyclone Hart and Boogaloo Watts and Willie Monroe and Hagler. Hagler was from New England, and I never had a high opinion of New England fighters because as a kid, most of the fighters I knew from New England were white guys.
Okay.
Okay? And as a kid, I didn't have a high opinion of them. Later, I did. But so Hagler, I mean, I knew he was black. I knew he was from Newark. And I think he was 25 wins and one draw when Sam Silverman, the promoter from New England, called me to put him in. And I paid him $2,000 to fight Boogaloo Watts on January 13th, 1976 at the Spectrum.
Mm.
And he came to town spouting, you know, talking poetry and things like that. And then he went out and see, this is where Boogaloo Watts, the family, gets upset. And he got the decision over Hagler, but all you have to do is read the newspaper reports. And most people thought Hagler won the fight, okay?
Mm-hmm.
So that was, you know, that happens. I was thinking about this today. Every great fighter, listen, did Lewis beat Walcott the first time? No, but he got the decision. Did Ollie beat Norton the third time? No, he didn't, but he got it. Did he beat Jimmy Young? Who knows? Did he beat Doug? Every fighter that ever lived had those kind of nights.
Right.
Where they got a decision they didn't deserve. I've been on both sides. Anyway, so I had Willie the Worm scheduled to fight Vinnie Curto in March, and the Petronellis called me, and they said, Vinnie Curto's not going to show up. I said, well, we'll see. Well, we'll keep Hagler in the gym. Curto had fought a draw with Briscoe the year before that he didn't deserve, that Curto didn't deserve, but that's another story. So, of course, 10 days or 2 weeks before the fight, Curto pulled out.
Right.
And Hagler stepped in. So I don't want to hear from Hagler that he wasn't in shape.
Okay.
I don't want to hear that. He had actually had a fight in between the Watson. Anyway, he came to Philly, And the Petronelli said, you know, you did pretty good last time. We'll take the $2,000 guarantee, but we want a percentage of the cake. I said, fine. You know, it snowed like hell the day of the fight. Terrible snowstorm. Petronellis were sitting in the lobby of the hotel because they knew nobody was coming to the fight, so they weren't going to get their percentage.
Mm.
And we actually did about 3,500 people because everybody came down from North Philadelphia by the subway.
Right, okay.
And let me tell you something. That was Willie the Worm Monroe's greatest night.
Wow.
He beat up Marvin Hagler. Now, every round was a war.
Wow.
But Willie won seven out of ten. And even, like I say, I save everything. Even Hagler said in the papers the next day that he has a lot to learn, and I think Willie Monroe's already learned it. So, but the bigger problem, Chuck, was the storm was so bad, the film crew couldn't get there.
Wow.
So there's no film of that fight.
I was just getting ready to say I gotta watch that fight. And you say Willie was a little hard on Marvin, huh?
Oh, he stood in the pocket and he traded with him. And it was just a great fight.
Wow, what a loss, man. What a loss. My goodness, I can't believe that.
So when the fight was over, the Petronellis cornered me in outside the dressing room. I guess you haven't heard this story. And they get me there and they said, Russell, you got Briscoe, you got Watts, you got Hart, you got Monroe, you got all these guys. Why don't you take us on and we'll cut you in? And I said, what can I do with you? How I turned down 10% of Marvelous Marvin Hagler.
Mm.
Okay, so they kept calling. They said, Marvin wants to come back. You don't get that anymore. Guy comes into town and loses two fights. He doesn't want to come back.
Wow.
But Hagler wanted to come back because he wanted to prove that he could fight. So we brought him back finally in September with Cyclone Hart, September of 76, and he stopped him. Mm. Mark quit in his corner at the end of the eighth round, and that was Hagler's first win. And then he got Monroe up in Massachusetts the following February, and he beat him. And then in August of 77, he came back and he knocked Monroe out at the Spectrum in two rounds. And a year later, he fought Briscoe. But listen, in all fairness to Briscoe, I'm not saying he was the fighter Hagler became, but in those days, 35 was old. Especially a guy who wound up with 96 fights. But Hagler still wouldn't stand and trade with him.
Right.
He got cut early, Hagler did, and he boxed. And it was smart.
Right, right.
And he went the limit. But Hagler, see, that's the thing people don't... He wanted to get better. He wanted to keep coming to Philly. He wanted those tough fights. And that's what, you know, Chandler was like that. Charles Brewer was like that.
Right.
These guys wanted to see, they wanted to be the best. It wasn't just about grabbing the money and fighting some turkey on television. It was just about being, it was a different world back then. And, you know, Hagler, and that's what set Hagler apart from all these other guys. He kept getting better, Hagler, and he got better. Lou Duva once told me, you fighters get better by fighting better fighters.
Right.
And that was Hagler's mindset. Mm. And it paid off for him.
So let me ask you a question. What's your opinion on the Marvin Hagler-Ray Leonard fight? How do you feel about that?
Well, that was not Hagler in there that night. He was all worn out from the Mugabe fight.
Right.
Hagler liked to drink a lot. Leonard knew that. But even so, and the referee that night was terrible.
Mm.
He let Leonard get away with holding Hagler behind the neck. If you look at it, he hit Hagler low a few times with good shots low.
Punched him in his throat a couple of times, too.
What's that?
I said Leonard punched Hagler in the throat a couple of times, too.
Yeah, well, you're allowed to punch a guy in the throat, but it was a close fight. I mean, I think a draw would have been fair. think a draw would have been fair.
You know what? I respect your right to feel that way. And again, this is coming from an avid Marvin Hagler fan. But, you know, the same thing what you said, you know, Ray Leonard passed on Hagler. Hagler initially called him out in 1982.
In October, undisputed middleweight champion Marvelous Marvin Hagler journeyed to San Remo, Italy, and defeated Fulgencio Ubelmetias with a crushing Teflon knockout. The world awaited a Hagler-Leonard showdown.
In San Remo, the crush of reporters wondering if Sugar Ray Leonard would challenge Marvelous Marvin Hagler was overwhelming. I guess everyone was trying to figure out my decision. They found out soon enough.
Talking about money, you talk about Fort Knox. And this is the only man that can make that possible, Marvelous Marvin Hagler. But unfortunately, it never happened.
And, you know, Ray was just coming off of that hard fight with Tommy Hearns. I don't believe that Ray Leonard had a detached retina. I think he went and got a doctor's note. But he knew in his mind he would fight Hagler one day. But to me, Ray just sat on the sideline and watched Marvin take all those hard fights. And see, you talk about the Mugabe fight, but there was the fight with Juan Domingo Roldan. There was the fight with Tommy Hearns. There was the fight with Roberto Duran, who pushed him to the limit. So Hagler had a lot of tough fights while Ray was sitting on the sideline, slow walking him. I'm on the telephone with Eddie Everett, the brother of the late, great Tyrone Mean Machine Everett. And he's going to give me his experiences, his opinions, his points of views on Philadelphia boxing promoter J. Russell Peltz. Take it away, Eddie.
Okay. Last year, I honored Russell Peltz at my Family of Boxing Award ceremony in South Philly. And a lot of people asked me, why did I honor Peltz? And I let them know that Peltz is a big part of Philly history, and especially our black history for our black champions in boxing. So Peltz played a big role in getting my brother championship fight, Matthew Saad Muhammad, Jeff Chandler, and many of the other fighters in Philly. Benny Briscoe was one of his favorites, and he did a lot for Benny Briscoe's career and a whole lot of other fighters. So Peltz brought back boxing, I think, in 1969 when he came on the scene. Boxing was dead, and he brought it back and gave fighters like my brother Tyrone and Michael Everett and friends like Johnny Carter, Dancing Machine, the opportunity to follow their dream and become world champion. So Russell Peltz is deserving of all of the recognition that he gets, and I was honored to give him the Family Boxers Award. And he said that he was in Florida, but he would not have missed this ceremony for nothing in the world. So I really appreciate him coming back from Florida to the event to celebrate with all of the great fighters that was there. He was so honored to be there. He stayed to the end because there were so many other old fighters that was there that he helped their careers, that he just stayed until the end to talk to everybody. So I think, you know, Russell Peltz is definitely deserving of everything that he gets.
That's wonderful right there, man. And you know, the thing about it is, when it's all said and done, man, when you look at it from an economic aspect, man, Russell Peltz helped people get at a dollar, man. Now, what you did with the dollar after Russell helped you get it, that was something totally different. But at the end of the day, Russell provided the means for people to earn an honest living by doing what they like to do. You know what I mean?
Right.
Right.
And this was their dream to become world champion. So he provided that avenue for them to follow their dream and achieve that dream. Because these guys put in the work, and this was their dream. You know, this is what they lived for. You know, and they're legends because of that. You know, and so that these fighters really, this was their dream.
Now that we're talking about controversial fights, how do you feel about the Chiron Everett Alfredo Escalera fight? Did you promote that fight? Yes,
I did. With Top Rank, it was fixed.
Oh, okay.
Fixed. Can I prove it? Can I tell you that was I there when the alleged $1,500 changed hands? No, I wasn't there. And I know who was involved. I know the guys who were involved from Philly that made the connections, but I can't say it because there's some cockamamie lawyer out there that'll call a family member and tell you that, you know, and I'll get sued.
Well, no, we don't want you getting sued.
I wasn't there when the money changed hands.
Yeah, well,
you're going to tell me, you're going to look at that fight and tell me that Everett, I mean, if you want to give Escalera every benefit in the world, and it wasn't a great fight. It was not a great fight. It was a great event.
Right.
And it didn't become a great fight until Escalera bit in the Everett's forehead in the 13th round and the blood started pouring out. And then Everett fought his ass off. But, I mean, if you give Escalera 5 rounds in that fight, you're really bending over backwards out of 15. I'm going to sit down with a judge and he's going to show me where Escalera won these rounds.
Right.
It's, and even today I tell this story. I'm standing at ringside and Ed Derrian is getting ready to read the scores. My chest is on the ring. I mean, I'm right at the ring touching it. And he starts with the Philly judge. He says, Judge Lutress of Pennsylvania scores at 145 Escalera, 143. And the crowd goes crazy.
Right.
I'm looking at Eddie. I'm looking at him. And I said, Eddie, you're such a schmuck. You just read the score backwards. I mean, that's how naive I was, how shocked I was.
Right, right.
How could the Philly judge, how could he do that?
Right, right.
I mean, that's seven to five with three even. I mean, it wasn't even in the same solar system.
Right, right.
So, listen, was it going to change his life? It's like saying if Meldrick Taylor had gotten the win over Chavez, it would have changed his life. I don't believe any of that.
Well,
it's, you know, we are who, you know what, Teddy Atlas has a great saying that I love. It says, people born round don't die square. You know, we are who we are.
Hold on, wait a minute. So, say that again, sir. About Teddy Atlas. Quote Teddy again.
People born round don't die square.
Wow. I never heard that before. But, sir, wait a minute. I'm just, so that I'm clear.
You can disagree.
No, I'm not disagreeing. I'm just posing a question. You don't think that if Everett would have won the title or had Meldrick Taylor beaten Chavez, it wouldn't have changed their life?
Temporarily.
Okay.
You mean they would have made more money? Everett was making good money. Look on the computer sometime when you get a chance, because I did that in my book. If I say that Briscoe got $30,000 without TV in 1976 to fight Hart, when you go to the computer and say, give me the value today of $30,000 in 1976, it's going to tell you it's like $200,000.
Okay.
That's without television.
Right.
That's just selling tickets. So Everett was making, on the average at the spectrum coming up, he was making $8,000, $9,000, $10,000 a show, fighting 5-6 times a year. Look at the computer and see that's like $50,000, $60,000 today with no television.
Right.
That's good money.
Right, right.
So you're going to tell me he was going to move out of the neighborhood? Even Mike, his brother Mike.
Right, Mike Everett. I know him from the gym.
In Boxing Babylon, told Nigel Collins, the writer, that they were into the drug scene back then.
This
was Philly in the 70s.
Right.
There was a lot of that going on in the I read a book recently called Black Brothers, Inc.
Yeah, that's an old book. I've seen that, yeah.
Yeah, it's a great book. If you haven't read it, you should read it. And I'm thinking to myself, oh my God, I was in all these places.
Right, right.
Going to all these bars, you know, sell tickets, you know, meet guys, and I'm saying, wow, you know, what was I thinking? You know, how come I didn't know what was going on? But I don't know. I don't think it would have changed. Listen, Melcher Taylor made a shitload of money.
Right.
Okay? He did.
Right.
But it's all gone.
Yeah.
All gone. So he would have made twice as much money. So you're going to tell me he would have held on to it? I don't think so.
Right.
That's just my opinion.
What are your thoughts on Floyd Mayweather and the way he's, you know, Floyd Mayweather in boxing and the way he's been promoting and all that? What is your opinion on that?
Attitude has hurt boxing. He's so concentrated and so consumed with being undefeated that a lot of younger fighters have taken the attitude that they can't lose, and therefore they don't take competitive fights because they're all worried about the loss column. And sometimes you can't blame them, because some of the people who buy the fights for television, the TV executives, they just look at your record.
Right.
And if your record is like 13-6, like a guy like Garrett Wilson, who made great fights, he can't get on TV. And instead, they'll take someone who couldn't shine Garrett Wilson's shoes, but his record is 15-0.
Right.
They'll put him on. And that has hurt boxing. That's really hurt boxing in recent years. It's changed the mindset of the people who manage and train fighters, and I think it's detrimental to the business. I really do.
You know what, sir? I agree with you, and I'll tell you, I give you two solid examples. Buster the Demon Drayton and Fearless Fred Pendleton. Two guys that had shabby records. Some of the fights that they had were, you know, they you know, they could have went either way. Really, you could have went the way of our guys out of Philly. But those guys turned their career around. Again, I was present. When I say present, I was on the peripheral of when Fred Pendleton challenged Daryl Martin for the Pennsylvania title. Bowie Fisher and those guys were kind of sort of taking it light, and guys, the talk at the gym was like pretty much warning Bowie and them, like, yo man, this boy Pendleton, man, is pretty good, man. He, you know, a lot of them losses, man, they could have won either way. And Fred Pendleton, he went in there, he knocked Daryl Martin out, I believe it was in the fourth round. And, you know, he didn't stop until he got to the world title. And, I mean, he won the world title. And, you know, the guy, I mean, but again, it goes back to what you're talking about, you know, and I agree with you wholeheartedly. And I go back and forth with guys on the internet about it. You know, just because a guy lost a fight, man, it's really not the end of the world if a guy loses a fight.
Well, I promoted that fight at the Zembo Mosque in Harrisburg.
Ah.
Martin, and I made a mistake because it was Martin's second. Martin was from Harrisburg, even though he was training out of Philly.
Right.
I was trying to build him into an attraction up there, and I fell for Pendleton's record, even though I'd seen Pendleton because he'd had Anthony Fletcher on the floor losing a close decision.
Mm.
But I made the fight, and yeah, Martin. That was the end of really Martin's career as a potential prospect, because Martin had a great style.
Right.
Was very fan friendly, and you know, looking back, I should have never made the fight, but I did, and Pendleton's career took off from there.
Oddly enough, my wife is cousins with Andre Sharpe's sister, and tell me if I'm wrong or not. Wasn't there talk of Andre Sharpe and Daryl Martin?
I don't remember. I think Martin was pretty established. Sharpe didn't turn pro until 84.
Okay.
I don't know. I don't recall trying to make that fight. No,
okay.
I don't recall that.
Okay. Well,
Andre Sharpe, what's he up to? Is he around?
Oh, Andre Sharpe, he got a bunch of rental properties, man. He sold a property off of... right up there off of Girard Avenue, man. He cashed in. He made a mint. Andre Sharpe is doing real well
for
himself.
Good for him.
Sir, I need to know your opinion on the great Bernard the Executioner Hopkins, sir. A guy, and I know you had Bernard starting out, but How do you feel about Bernard? What are some of your... I personally... Bernard is second to Marvin. Marvin Hagler is my number one guy. Then I'd say Bernard and then Roy Jones. But how do you... Tell me your thoughts about working with the great Bernard Hopkins and, you know, your opinions on him from, you know, from 0 to 100, sir.
He only fought for me twice that I can remember. I didn't really have him at all. He fought for me twice at the Blue Rise. He's going to go, he's the first bout. Well, he's in the Hall of Fame. He got in, right?
Right.
Yeah, but it was postponed.
Right.
It's one of the, you're talking in middleweights, you rate him right behind that? Well,
I'm just talking about, like, Marvin Hagler's my favorite guy. Then after Marvin Hagler, I say Bernard Hopkins, because I actually seen Bernard when he had absolutely no fights, and, you know, he did exactly what he said he was going to do, and I'm proud of him for it, you know? So that's
Bernard Hopkins had old school mentality.
Right.
In an era when hardly anybody else did.
Right.
So he knew how to get, I don't know, I mean, I love Bernard and we joke all the time, and I picked him. I was one of the few people that picked him to beat Trinidad, and
right.
he knew it.
Right.
And he thanked me afterward, but would that mindset have worked back in the 50s and 60s?
Mm.
Like, in other words, when a lot of fighters had that mindset.
Ah.
Hey, that's not to take anything away from him.
Right.
He's had an incredible career. Longevity at the top, to me, is the criteria for the Hall of Fame. There's way too many people in the Hall of Fame in Canastota that have no business being there.
Wow.
And there's people who do deserve to be in there that aren't there, but that's another argument. Bernard Hopkins, I mean, he did everything he set out to do, and losing his first pro fight,
right,
and still coming back, and then his career was over, as I mentioned earlier. In my mind, it was over until they put him in with Kelly Pavlik, and it revived his whole career. And there was no way, I had Antonio Tarver for a while. There was no way a guy with Antonio Tarver's mindset could ever beat, on his best day, a guy with Bernard Hopkins' mindset. Because Bernard Hopkins could beat you mentally.
Yeah. Yeah, Bernard Hopkins knew how to push people's buttons. Sir, I mean, Russell, I'll tell you what. I'll give you a call. I appreciate what we've done thus far, and I'll call you maybe tomorrow or the day after, and we'll set up our next interview.
Okay, Chuck. Very good. You're allowed to disagree with me on things I say.
I love to disagree with people. Don't worry about it. If you said something I didn't agree with, I'd be all over you like a leopard. So you ain't got to worry about that.
Okay.
Have very a great good. Day. Yep.
Oh, say hello to, if you talk to Andre Sharp, tell him I say hello.
You got it. I'm on the phone with Fred Jenkins, legendary boxing trainer and director of the ABC Gym. Hey, Mr. Jenkins, how you doing today, sir?
I'm good.
Let me ask you a question. I know that you worked with Russell Peltz for many years, and I'm just curious, sir, what's your estimation of him?
He's been pretty fair with me.
Mm-hmm.
I've been dealing with different promoters. I worked with several promoters. I work with Lou Duva, I work with Don King. I work with several promoters. And they were all pretty fair with me.
That sounds like a winner to me, sir. Is that all you wanna say about Mr. Peltz, sir?
One thing about Mr. Peltz, he's strictly business. And he wanna make sure you know, your fighters is working together, and most promoters don't really care.
Right.
But, you know, usually training a fighter usually moves together. When the fighters start moving separately, that's when you have conflict.
Right, right, right. And you got a lot of great fights with Russell Peltz. You had so many great fighters come out that ABC gym of yours. And you had the great Rodney Moore, the great Charlie Choo Choo Brown. And speaking of the great Charlie Choo Choo Brown, sir, I sent you some pictures of you and Charlie. Did you get them?
Yeah.
I'm currently at the office of J. Russell Peltz, Philadelphia fight promoter, the Bob Arum and the Don King of Philadelphia.
Russell, you insisted I call you Russell. I saw that your very first world champion was Marvin Johnson. Marvin Johnson affiliated with my last trainer, Leon Tabbs. When he won that world championship, how did you feel? Did you feel like, did you live vicariously through him? Did you actually win a world championship when Marvin Johnson won his first world championship?
Actually, that was the first of his three. I was in a hotel room at 10th and Packer because I couldn't make the trip to Sicily because two nights later, Mike Rossman was defending his title at the Spectrum, so I had to stay behind. So I watched it on television with the late Stan Hockman. I forget who else was in the room. It was just the three of us watching it on television. And I went crazy. I jumped up. I ran out of the room. I got in my car, drove home, told my wife. It was December, I think it was December 2nd, 1978. Actually, yes, there it is. Okay. Yeah, he was my first world champion. It was a great feeling.
And you would go on to have a bunch of other world champions, being a boxing promoter. Years ago, I seen a movie. I can't remember the name of it. I think they was doing something on Don King. But Don King said, I go in the ring with the champion, and I leave out the ring with the champion. So with that said, how many world champions have you had in your illustrious career as a fight promoter?
Oh, boy, I don't know, Chuck. You know, the business was different then. I mean, you consider Matthew Saad Muhammad my world champion because he had all his big fights leading up to and including the title fight. In other words, back in those days, promoters didn't really have their own fighters. You promoted the biggest fight, you bid on it, and you made money for the fight. Promotional contracts came into vogue after that, but Marvin, so if I count Saad Muhammad, Marvin Johnson, Robert Hines, Choo Choo Brown, Gary Hinton, Arturo Gatti, nobody really knows that I had 50% of the promotional contract on Arturo Gatti up until the Mickey Ward fights. Kasim Uma, Prince Charles Williams, the most recent Jason Sosa. Oh, best fighter ever had, Jeff Chandler. How could I forget him?
Charles the Hatchet Brewer.
Charles the Hatchet Brewer. I hope I haven't left anybody
out. Well, if you left anybody out, it wouldn't be
Mike Rossman. Do you count Mike Rossman? I don't know.
Yeah, Mike Rossman. I met Mike Rossman a couple of years. As a matter of fact, I think we were at the Benny Bisco Awards. Me and Buster Drayton. Buster's like a big. Didn't you have Buster?
No. Buster only fought for me maybe a couple, two, three times.
Okay. Well, yeah, he and I were hanging out together, and I seen Mike hanging around, but I didn't know who he was because the Mike Rossman I knew was the Mike Rossman from the 80s and the 70s, and I'm standing there next to Buster, and Mike is talking to Buster, and he says, Chuck, he said, you know this guy right here, man? I said, nah, should I know him? He said, that's Mike Rossman. I said, oh, you mean the Jewish bomber? And Mike and I were fast friends. I haven't seen him in years. He probably wouldn't remember me. But, yeah, man, can you tell me about Mike? I personally, man, standing there talking to Mike with Buster, Mike is a guy that I really like. So anything enlightening or motivational that you can share with me about Mike?
Mike, he never really realized his full potential. That night he beat Galindez in New Orleans on the Ali Spinks rematch card was like the perfect fight because he went to Deer Lake to train for that fight. That was the only time really in his whole life he was probably in 100% condition. It's ironic that when he retired in 1983, when we were really together, then that year he fought four times and won them all. And he was only 27 years old.
Wow.
And he walked away. He was just, he had demons, Mike. Mike had trouble with alcohol. And he was never a big fan of boxing. And he just...
Really?
Yeah.
That's sad.
He just didn't like the business. He didn't listen. Imagine finding out that your father is getting paid on the side while you're fighting money that should have been part of your purse.
Wow, yeah.
I mean, I can't imagine that. And, you know, it soured him on the business.
Yeah, I can understand that. I mean, I was, I saw boxing from both sides. And that would be rough. And while we're on the subject, let's get through it quickly. How do you, can you tell me if you just shared one part of the ugliness of boxing. You mind sharing with me maybe like about maybe one or two other accounts where boxing really would put a sour taste in a person's mouth? And I know you saw a lot of it.
The first time I ever saw a manager do that was in 1972 when a fighter from Trinidad by the name of Matt Donovan came to Philly to fight Cyclone Hart. And I made the deal through George Gainford, who was the manager of Sugar Ray Robinson.
Right.
And we had agreed on, I know this because I'm putting it in my book, and I just went over this the other day. We had agreed on $3,500. Now, it doesn't sound like a lot now, but in 1972, it was a lot of money.
Right.
So I sent him, in those days you mailed the contract out, there were no fax machines. And the next thing I knew, he showed up in my office like a week later. I mean, you know, it's pretty impressive. George Gainford, you know, one of the best known managers in boxing. And he brought the contract back and he wanted me to change it. Instead of putting $3,500 on the contract, he wanted me to put $3,000 on the contract and pay him $500 on the side. Now, I can't be 100% sure if Gainford had a contract on Matt Donovan or not. My point is, on top of the $500, did he also take a piece out of Donovan's $3,000?
Right,
I can't say for sure.
Right.
But why didn't he make that deal with me when he first made the fight?
Right.
The phone.
Right.
So, listen, I've seen promoters, I've seen managers double deal their own fighters. I've seen promoters, like if I have a fighter and Bob Arum wants to use the fighter. So it's like if MGM has an actor and Warner Brothers wanted to use the actor back in the old days, they had to pay MGM a fee.
Right.
So that's what it's like in boxing.
Okay.
The problem is, some of the promotional contracts are written so loosely that if Bob Arum were to say to me, and I'm just using Arum, it could be King, it could be Golden Boy, it could be Heyman. Let's say he tells me there's $100,000 on the table, okay? My contracts specify that if the fighter's under contract to me, meaning I've helped develop him, that out of that $100,000, I'm entitled to 20%. So I get $20,000 and the fighter gets $80,000.
Right.
Okay?
Right.
I've seen deals where the fighter gets $50,000 and the promoter gets $50,000.
Right.
And I say to them, I say, how do you get away? Because before the Muhammad Ali Act came into being, it was really the Wild West. Now, the problem with the Muhammad Ali Act, in the Muhammad Ali Act, and most fighters don't even know this, they're entitled to know how much money is on the table.
They're supposed to get 66%, if I understand correct.
That's out of their manager contract.
Ah, okay.
I'm talking about if a fighter's under contract to me, he's entitled to know that there's $100,000 on the table.
Right, I got you.
It's a shame. Like a booking agent will pull me up, and I'll say, and he'll say, how much is the fight worth? And I'll say to him, I'll say $10,000. He says, that's good. What about the fighter?
Wow. You know,
I mean, it's a, it's a joke. So, you know, I can't do it. I say to some of these guys, I'm not going to do that.
Right.
I just can't do that.
Right, right. I heard you mention Bob Arum, and while we're on the subject, tell me about your relationships and your interactions, and if you can, sir, if any time you could add a humorous note to any of this, please do so. Bob Arum, Don King, Mickey Duff, and Lou Duva. These are the most prominent guys I might know. Shelley Finkel. But anything, you know, you don't have to give them all to me, but any experiences that you had with any of these guys that stands out, and again, if it could be lighthearted, that would really be cool.
Oh boy, lighthearted experiences in boxing. That's not an everyday occurrence, Chuck. Mickey Duff, he's got a great line. He had two great lines, Mickey Duff. Because, see, listen, the way I was raised, Chuck, is, like, I went to Temple, okay?
Right, gotcha.
So, I bleed cherry and white.
Gotcha.
I don't care if the basketball team is 5-20, they're still my team.
Gotcha.
So, in boxing, I believe that a fighter is with me from Jump Street, he should be with me at the end. And Mickey Duff says, if you want loyalty, buy a dog.
Damn.
Okay. I don't buy that. It's a great line. It is a great line. Dogs are loyal. But then there was Marty Feldman who came along.
I remember Marty.
Managed and trained Animal Fletcher and Augie Pantelis and all those guys.
Don't forget Prince Charles Williams.
Right. The job he did with pre-made Prince Charles Williams. Marty said, there's no such thing as 99%. He said, you're either 100% loyal or you're not. He said he would tell me, don't tell me you've been with me for 5 years and now you can't be with me this time because of extenuating circumstances. I'll never forget it. There's no such thing as 99%. So, you know, that's the way I was raised.
Was Marty older than you, Russ?
Marty, I guess Marty was a good 10 years older than
okay.
I was, at least. Yeah.
Right, right.
Because Marty was a pro. Marty was the main event on Benny Briscoe's pro debut in 62.
Damn.
So, yeah, Marty got to be was a good 10 years older than I was. Listen, what he did with Prince Charles Williams, what a resurrection job that was.
Hey, you know I liked about Marty, man. Whenever you see, he might say, hey, Chucky! Or he might say, hey, Russell! Marty Feldman. Yeah, he was a great guy.
Say, Russell Peltz, born in Philadelphia so he could be near his mother.
Great.
Get the lines,
great, Marty. Yeah, Marty was a cool, he was a cool, cool guy. What is the best fight that you promoted and the best fights that you ever saw? For example, Oscar Muniz and Johnny Carter. I don't know, I think you might have promoted that. But that was a great fight. It wasn't comparable to Iran Barkley and Roberto Duran, but it was still a great fight.
I can't believe you remember that fight.
Oh yeah, I used to watch it on Prism Boxing, man.
Best fight I ever saw in person. I was fortunate to have promoted, which was in July 26, 1977 at the Spectrum. When then Matthew Franklin knocked out Marvin Johnson in the last round, the 12th round of their fight for the North American Boxing Federation light heavyweight title.
Wow.
There's no such thing as a feeling out round. It was just an incredible brawl and was even on the scorecards, 1-1-1 going into the 12th round. When Matthew knocked him out, now if that's number one, Matthew and Richie Cates would be 1A.
Wow, okay.
When they were each on the floor, and Matthew stopped him in the 6th or 7th round, I promoted that. And the first fight between Benny Briscoe and Cyclone Hart.
I heard that was a rough one.
10-round draw at the Spectrum in 1975. I mean, I was at, now as far as other fights that I saw that I didn't promote.
Right.
I was at the first Mickey Ward Arturo Gatti fight.
Okay.
I'm trying to think. I think I was involved with Mickey Ward at the time. I was at the fight between, because I was working at Diego Corrales and Jose Luis Castillo, when Corrales was down twice, like in the 10th round, and got up and knocked Castillo out. But,
right.
You know, been so many fights between people that even you wouldn't remember, like 6-round fights. I was at Ali Frazier 1.
Right.
Which was the greatest, to me, probably the greatest sporting event ever, maybe the greatest social event ever. You know, certainly of my lifetime, of my generation.
Right, right.
And so many great fights. You could just look at the films from the Blue Horizon.
Yeah.
And just cover your eyes and I'll take that one.
Right.
And just great fights.
You promoted a lot of fighters, man. You've seen the best of them from the top to bottom. For example, if I could see 3 guys win championships, I would have liked to see Marvis Frazier win a world championship. I would have liked to see my friend Mike Brown win a world championship. And I would have liked to see Jesse Thunder Ferguson win championships. All personal friends of mine. You tell me, who are some guys that you would have really have liked to see win world titles?
Well, the obvious one's Benny Briscoe.
Ah, okay.
My first fighter. You know, you never fall in love with a fighter, but we did. We loved each other. And George Benton.
Ah, okay.
There's a guy who fought. I looked it up. The middleweight title changed hands 22 times during his career.
Dang.
And this was before the bullshit alphabets. And not only did he not win a title, he never even got a shot. Even
wow.
though he beat Joey Girardello, Jimmy Ellis, and Freddie Little, all 3 world champions at different times. So I'm trying to think, you know, guys that came close but couldn't. Briscoe had 3 shots, Benton had none. I don't know.
That's all right.
Tony Thornton, the punch.
Tony Thornton, yeah, he was a great guy.
Tony
yeah.
Thornton was the. I got a story. You got time?
No, I'm good.
Tony Thornton was managed by Joe Grammy. You know who Joe Grammy was?
I don't know him, no.
Most. Just to qualify it, I could qualify it by saying he was the greatest black manager ever in Philly, but I'd say he was the greatest manager ever. He managed Bob Montgomery, the lightweight champ. From the 40s, Tex Cobb, Richie Cates, Tony Thornton, Charlie Scott. Anyway, he managed Tony Thornton, probably on a handshake, and I had a handshake to promote Tony Thornton. So Grammy died in 1990, and Tony came over here, and we walked, when it was about 2-3 blocks from here, we walked to the funeral home, and when the, this is one of my favorite stories.
Okay.
When the funeral was over, he came back here. He said, "What do you want to do as far as my career now?" Because his manager was gone. I said, "I'll tell you what, I'll promote you and I'll manage you for 10%. So we shook hands and he went home. And I started thinking about it. I said, "Jesus, Russell, 10%? You're going to manage him and you're going to promote him for 10%? So I called him on the phone. I said, "Tony, I think I sold myself short." You know what he told me?
Go ahead.
He said, "I think so too."
Yeah.
Who would say that? What fighter would say that? He said, "What do you think is fair?" I said, 20% is fair. He said, "You're right." So that was the extent of our contract, that phone call. And he wound up getting 3 title shots. Chris Eubank, James Toney, Roy Jones. And whenever the guy would come in to pay, he'd say, "Give the money to Russell, and he'll take care of it." So a few years later, after he lost to Eubank and Toney, he hadn't fought after Toney for a year, he called me up. He said, "Listen, there's 2 lawyers in town. They want to manage me. They say you don't have any juice left." This was like 1994. I said, "I'll tell you what, Tony, have them give you $5,000. Just tell them to give you $5,000, I'll walk away."
Mm-hmm.
So he calls me back a week later. He said, they won't give me five. I said, have him give you 2,500 and I'll walk away.
Mm-hmm.
So he calls me back a week later. He says, they won't give me 2,500. I put him in a fight at the Blue Horizon with a guy named Lindsey Morgan, who was like 25 wins and 25 losses.
Damn.
Tony got the decision, but he didn't. It was, you know.
Right, right. Hometown.
So, and it was a terrible fight. Main event at the Blue Horizon, and people started calling me on the phone. What are you doing? Why do we have to watch this guy again? Because, you know, we were selling out every show, and going to the Blue Horizon was really
hot. It was an event, yeah.
In the 90s.
Yeah.
I put him in with a guy named Darren Zenner from New York for the vacant USBA super middleweight title. He was sensational. He knocked Zenner out in the second round.
Cool, right.
He became the number one contender for Roy Jones, and his next fight was $250,000. His last fight. And these guys wouldn't give him 2,500. And his hands, Tony had bad hands.
Right.
He went into the, I mean, listen, he wouldn't have beat Roy Jones with good hands.
Right, right.
But he went in with bad hands, and he knew it. But for $250,000 in 1995, he wasn't going to walk away from the fight.
Right, right.
But, you know, the saddest thing about Tony was that he got killed on a motorcycle.
I didn't even know he was dead.
About 10 years ago.
Damn.
Not even 10 years. He was crossing the Ben Franklin Bridge, I think, or the Walt Whitman. And on his motorcycle on a bus sideswipe.
You know, man, staying on that subject, we lost this. First of all, this is news to me that Tony Thornton has deceased. He's a guy that I knew from the Champs Gym. Speaking of fighters that died on motorcycles, let's talk about James Shuler. Let's talk about Andre Prophet. I believe you did have Andre Prophet, yes. I remember when you guys were developing him. Let's have it. Those guys there.
I don't think Shuler ever fought for me. I didn't have much to do with Shuler. I think when he made it to a certain level, he was handled first by Butch Lewis. And then I don't know if Lewis was involved when he fought Tommy Hearns. I'm not sure. But listen, you know, guys get knocked out in one round.
Right.
You know who got knocked out in one round? Jack Dempsey, Max Schmeling, Bob Montgomery, Ken Norton, Michael Spinks. I mean, some of the greatest fighters ever. Emil Griffith,
right.
Joey Maxim.
Right.
They get knocked out in one round. It happens. You catch a guy warming up. Andre the Prophet, boy, he was good size. I used to watch him spar in Prince Charles Williams at Champs on 24th Street, boy.
Last time.
You couldn't tell who was the champ.
Yeah.
Who was the young guy coming up.
Yeah.
He had such potential, and then he was scheduled to fight for me at the Northeast Armory out on the Boulevard in August of 88, and I got a call about a week ahead of time saying he got killed in a motorcycle accident. Unlimited potential. And he was still raw.
I think he was only had maybe like 11 or 12 fights.
That's about it.
Yeah. Tell me some great boxing trainers. You often hear people talk about the fighters.
Okay, well, first of all, I'm not a big proponent of the word great.
Okay.
But
how about good?
Whoever I leave out will be upset. I think Jimmy Arthur,
okay.
One of the most underrated boxing trainers of my time, who made Tyrone Everett.
Ah.
Outstanding trainer. Marty Feldman, when I put him in as the trainer for Prince Charles Williams, coming off a loss to Marvin Johnson and going nowhere with like a 12-4 record, that's when I signed Prince Charles Williams, and Marty was the trainer. It was years and years and years before Prince Charles lost another fight, won the world title. I'm just keeping this to Philadelphia.
Okay.
See, a lot of trainers are good trainers, but they're not good managers.
Right.
Okay? Eddie Futch was as good a trainer as there ever was, but he was not a great manager. But he helped me a lot. So, Eddie Futch, I can include Eddie Futch because he was from Philly.
I never knew that. I didn't know Eddie.
I mean, he lived in Philly for years.
Okay.
He was training Frazier.
Okay.
Willie the Worm Monroe, Bobick, Wayne Bobick. And of course, he brought Hedgeman Lewis here to train for a while. I couldn't tell you enough about Yank Durham because, you know, he died in 73, and I don't know.
Yank was the guy that trained Joe, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
And it was his real his manager. Yeah. But before Joe, I don't know. George Benton.
Yeah.
George
okay.
Benton is as good as any trainer of my lifetime.
Okay.
He was George Benton. I wish, you know what, one of my regrets, as much time as I spent in the gyms with all the old timers
right.
when I was a kid, I didn't spend enough time with them. I didn't sit there and talk old boxing history with them. I got some stories, but not enough.
Right, yeah, I understand.
Joe Granby, before he became a manager, solely a manager, was an excellent trainer. I don't know. I'm just thinking of all the trainers who are going to be pissed off on their knees.
So I didn't hear you say anything about Al Fennell or Augie Shimeka, sir.
Al Fennell, yeah, he developed Robert Hines.
Robert Bam Bam Hines, sir, a man that you took to the junior middleweight championship, sir.
What a night that was to get off the floor twice.
Yeah.
The ironic thing was it was exactly 1 year after Prince Charles Williams got off the floor twice to beat Bobby Chez.
I didn't know that. I didn't know Chez had him down.
Oh, yeah, he was out. It was over, just like Hines.
I got to watch that fight.
Yeah. Second or third round. But, you know, Al Fennell only passed away young.
Tucci Gorman, sir.
Tucci Gorman trained Gary Hinton.
The executioner Hinton, sir. You're leaving.
He won the title in Lucca, Italy. Lucca, Italy.
Also, how would you like to be remembered when it's all said and done, man? At the very end of it, how would you like to be remembered?
Just the guy who made good fights. That's all. I tell new promoters, even though I discourage them from getting into business because it's so tough, I say just make good fights, because even if you don't make it, people can never criticize you for making bad fights. Mm. Listen, and I've said this for years. People are bitching today about paying $15 to go see a movie. I said, we're charging people $30, $50, $60, $80, $100 to see a fight. They don't want to see Russell's fighters knocking out all the other guys in one or two rounds. They don't want to see the guy in the red corner winning every fight.
Right.
They don't want to see... People want to see competitive fights.
Mm-hmm.
I think they're more interested in seeing competitive fights than they are... They should be than they are in seeing big names blow over somebody. I just want to... That's all.
Yeah.
My name is Eric Turner. And I'm a boxing fan and former amateur boxer. I met Russell Peltz through a young lady by the name of Brittany Rogers. Russell Peltz was her mentor, and she was promoting her first fight. I was still in the Army. And she asked me to sing the national anthem at her first boxing match.
Oh, okay, cool.
So I have a little bit of vocals going on, too.
Okay, a singer.
I sung the national anthem on the Army base and the Little League World Series. So if you need somebody to sing a tune, I'm your man. Russell Peltz became the director for boxing at the Spectrum.
Okay.
And that's where, you know, his reputation built from there. Some of his prominent fights were Betty Briscoe, Marvin Hagler, Boogaloo Watts, Marvin Hagler. And the one that had the most crowd indoors as a boxing event was Tyrone Everett and Escalera. Yeah, that was a great fight. After that, he went on to the Blue Horizon. And the Blue Horizon was very successful. When you say boxing in Philly, Russell Peltz is the first name that comes to mind.
Home country. Into the first round, McCarthy says he's always fighting bigger guys.
Everybody that likes to get hit in the body. But for a shorter fighter, it's easier to reach down to that body rather than to try to go up to the head. Boom, stinging right hand.
Champ,
Give me some of your experiences with Russell Peltz, boxing promoter, the man, the myth, the legend.
Well, you don't want my experiences. I told you that. My experiences with Russell, Russell's a very honest and good fella. But I don't know about how he's not the best guy protecting his guys per fighter. I think one time I was getting ready for a fight and we never, you know, we Russell believed in Russell thought he was an actual old school fighter because he handled like Benny Briscoe and all these guys who never wanted to watch tape or anything like that. So Russell felt as though he was. He didn't want any music when you walked into the room. And when the first time I had a fight coming up, Russell offered me a tape to watch my opponent. And I said, oh, wow, that's weird. I said, you know, it's very unusual. So the windup is I go and fight the guy. Here it wasn't even him. It was his brother. So that's the kind of promoter Russell was back in the day. Talk about spoil with fighters. Yeah, so, but a very honest fella. And we really enjoyed our association.
He told me something about Troy Dorsey. What did he mean? I told him don't be setting me up to get me in no trouble with you, man. But what's the story with Troy Dorsey?
That's the story.
Oh, that's the Troy Dorsey story.
Yeah. He's saying we never, you know, we never watched any tapes, and we never had that. And Russell, like I said, the one time tells me about fighting a guy and he's going to give me a tape of the guy. Here he sends me up the guy's brother. And Russell says, oh, they fight the same anyway.
J. Russell Peltz, the boy wonder promoter. Born with a silver spoon mouth. Good guy. Let me say this about Russell. Russell and I go way back 50 years. We had our arguments. We did a lot of business together. One thing about Russell, he may be cheap, but if he give you his word on something, you convince him to give his word is good. And what I always liked about Russell, when your fighter came out of that ring, my girl Maureen that was winning at the time, she had your check waiting for you. You know, like some promoter, you got to wait the end of the night. The only mistake that I see that Russell made in the 50 years that I've known him, how you let your own fighter get beat in his own neighborhood.
Who we talking about?
But Tyrone Hill.
Oh yeah, he spoke about that. Yeah, he actually spoke about that. Well, Russell said he was still young and naive, man. As a matter of fact, he said when the guy was reading the sports card, the announcer, Russell was like, "Man, this idiot is reading the damn wrong." He got it backwards. So Russell was very disappointed about that loss with Tyrone Everett.
Listen, man, you know I got a lot of calls, man. That you got 1,000 names. What is your name? Bob, Joe, Xander, Zulu, who you with? Don't get called Michael, somebody?
No, let me.
Dude, explain this to me, because I got to justify just when people see this, man.
All right, let me clear this up. The government, I can say the government because nobody's looking for me. The name is Joel Alexander Hobson. Joel is my first name, Alexander is my middle name. The streets call me Chucky for whatever the reason. That's what they call me. They call me Chucky, that's my nickname. Where it came from, I have absolutely no idea, okay? In the professional setting, I was either Joel or Joe when I drove tractor trailers, Chuck Hobson when I fought. Once I retired from the Air Force back in 04, and at some point, man, I started going through a midlife crisis, man. I decided I wanted to be an entertainer, a comedian. And I said, okay, I could be Joel Hobson on stage. I could be Chuck Hobson. I could be Joe. Then I thought, I said, damn, you know what? I never used my middle name in my life. I never used the name Alexander.
Right.
And then I'm thinking, I said, well, I don't think I want to be Alexander Hobson, but Xander. That's a cool ass name, Xander.
Yeah, it so, works. You got the Xander bar, got the Xander drink.
Right. So that's pretty much the.
Yeah, because my girl was wondering what your name was, man.
Right.
My girl, I don't know.
Bright lights and promises, a pocket full of dreams. That's what they paid me to be. I am a hometown queen, honey. is for me. When I was good and when I was bad, I never thought I'd end up this way. With no dreams to hide me, bright lights to guide me. How long does it take to make the grade? Everywhere I hear a ringing in my ears, drummer, let the music play. Give me small town blues, make it loud, make it do.
You gotta say bam.
Bam.
There you go.